Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Bartosz Brożek. I have the pleasure to welcome you here for the 2014 Copernicus Center Lecture. I would start with a short reflection. I would venture to say that we are witnessing a revolution. It is a revolution in the way we understand the functioning of the mind, the sources or the nature of mathematical cognition, or the origins of morality. And it is a revolution which is generated mainly by the findings of cognitive science, neuroscience, and psychology. And I believe that no philosopher should ignore these new findings of those sciences. No philosopher who, in a responsible way, would like to answer some old philosophical questions or the new philosophical questions which emerge in connection with the advances of the sciences. But at the same time, I believe that neuroscience can also make some use of philosophy. I would risk paraphrasing Kant and say that philosophy without neuroscience is empty, but neuroscience without philosophy is blind. And what I understand by this is that philosophers, in dealing with their philosophical problems, should take advantage of the best knowledge available to them. And in some contexts, it is the knowledge provided by neuroscience. At the same time, neuroscience, without a constant flow of ideas, often of philosophical origin, would have no clue what to look for in their scientific endeavors. And the goal of the Copernicus Center lectures is to address such fundamental problems. Copernicus Center lectures is a signature program of the Copernicus Center. The lectures were delivered in past by famous scientists and philosophers. In 2010 by Roger Penrose, in 2011 by Joseph Ledoux, in 2012 by George Ellis, and in 2013 by Michał Heller. It is no different this time. The Copernicus Center lecture this year will be delivered by Professor Patricia Churchland, a world-leading philosopher and cognitive scientist who contributed in an important and insightful way to our understanding of who we are and of our understanding of what does it mean to practice philosophy. Patricia Churchland is the author of innumerable books and articles, including Neurophilosophy, as well as Brain Trust, a book which has recently been translated into Polish. It is my great pleasure to welcome Professor Churchland in Krakow, and Pat, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much for the lovely introduction. And may I just say what a great, great pleasure it is to be here in Krakow again. It's such a beautiful and wonderful city. And of course, I've hit it at a perfect time in terms of the weather. It's also a great pleasure to be in the Copernicus Center and to get a feel for what it's doing, what it's aiming for. And I'm really thrilled to see how it's thriving and the sort of sense of how the various individuals work together and hash things out. And it's a small group, but I have the impression that small groups are often the places where the most sort of exciting and eventful things happen. Now, in today's talk, I want to say a little bit about morality. And it's been a topic that I haven't really wanted to address for a very long time because I was very confused by what contemporary moral philosophers were saying. I mostly couldn't understand what they were on about. And I think the basic reason goes something like this, that we all sort of realize that there must be two parts to the story of morality. And one part has to do with biology and why it is that we're social at all, why it is that we care at all. And I think of that, the circuitry and the genes that make that circuitry, as the biological platform. And on that platform, there can be a superstructure. And the form that that superstructure takes can vary a lot according to the particular contingencies that a group faces, its history, its ecology, the particular individuals that happen to be in it. Now, I'll say more towards the very end of the talk about, as it were, the political, social side of morality. But for the moment, I'm really interested in the biological platform, or the neurobiological platform. Now, as we all sort of appreciate, values are part of the way nervous systems of all organisms are put together and organized. That's just the way natural selection works. We have emotional and motivational systems that organize us to seek food and shelter, to avoid fearful things, and to go after prey, and in some cases, struggle with prey in order to get food. The body is designed over long periods of evolution to maintain homeostasis. And when those homeostatic values diverge from their normal set points, we are motivated. We feel pain or we feel an urgency to do something to correct those values. And of course, it's easiest to see that in the case of lack of oxygen. You certainly feel, when your oxygen supply is cut off, this tremendous feeling of urgency to make a change, a correction in your behavior. So there's a very deep sense in which the values of survival are really part of the most fundamental circuitry of all organisms that have any kind of nervous system whatsoever. Now, because organisms, and let's just talk not now about mammals, but let's say about insects and reptiles and so forth, because they often have to compete with one another in order to survive, we're all very well acquainted with the idea that natural selection picks out, so to speak, those animals who have the wherewithal, the morphology and the nervous system to outcompete the others. And in a certain sense, selfishness is at the root of it all. And so this has motivated some evolutionary biologists, for example, Richard Dawkins, to say, look, evolution depends on the idea of selfishness. And if perchance there are mutations that make me incur a cost in order to help you, I probably won't reproduce. Or if I do, and my children happen to carry that gene, they will be disadvantaged and eventually will be wiped out. And so Dawkins takes this view, which I think is actually quite common amongst evolutionary biologists, which is that morality is not part of our nature, that it is something that has to be imposed on us. And I think many people of a religious belief come to that view as well, that it doesn't come natural to us. We don't want to be that way. But if we're trained up properly and it's beaten into us, or we're terrified of doing anything else, then we will be moral. This was not Darwin's view. Interestingly enough, Darwin, who of course was an extraordinary observer of natural phenomena, Darwin knew that there are some species that are intensely social. He knew that humans were intensely social, but so also, for example, are wolves, our baboons, or chimpanzees, and various species of monkey. And he had the view that our moral sense or our conscience actually depends on three things. And here, I think he was actually amazingly prescient. He thought that social animals have social instincts, and by which he meant we, and now I'm talking about mammals, we like to be together. We feel good when we are together. We do not like long periods of isolation. We thrive and prosper better within the confines of a group. We do not prosper if we are completely isolated, which of course is part of the reason why, as a punishment, solitary confinement in prisons is sometimes used, and a most horrible punishment it truly is. So we feel pain in conditions of isolation, we feel good and satisfied and right in conditions of sociality. Those are the feelings he thought of as the social instincts. Now Darwin, of course, did not know anything much about the brain because at that time nothing much was known about the brain. So part of what I want to know is there a neurobiological account, even a sketchy account, that will help us understand what social instincts in mammals actually amount to? Now notice that Darwin had two other thoughts. He thought that habits were an important part, and here he was also spot on. It turns out that, especially in the case of mammals, and I'll talk more about this shortly, we learn the social conventions and practices, the taboos and the ways of the group, and we learn them almost as habits that we can use unconsciously in the appropriate conditions. And finally, he noticed that, of course, sometimes reason is engaged as we address and reflect on the nature of the conventions that guide our group. So in what I'm going to talk about today, it'll mostly be about what we think we are beginning to understand about the neurobiological platform for social instincts and how it is that we have such a platform. Just as a basic sort of background reminder, I like to put up this slide. And on the vertical axis, you can see years in millions. And on the spatial axis, on the horizontal axis, is space, distribution in space. And what you're looking at is a sort of graph of very early humans and finally Homo sapiens. And notice that, of course, there are many species of human. We are not the only ones. We overlapped with Homo neanderthalis for about 30,000 years. And now, of course, that the genome of Neanderthal has been done, it's possible to find out whether people have some Neanderthal genes now. And you'll be amused to know that 3.5% of my genome is Neanderthal. Now, my husband says that's what makes me good at using stone tools, but I'm not actually good at using stone tools. Anyway, notice that Homo erectus lived for a very long time, much, much longer than Homo sapiens has been on the face of the planet. Homo erectus was pretty interesting. They had brains of about 800 cc's. Yours is about 1300 to 1500 cc's, so it was a good bit smaller. Nevertheless, they clearly lived in social groups, and notice their dispersion. They were very widely dispersed. They even got themselves to Asia, and it's presumed that they built rafts by taking logs and lashing them together with vines so that they could cross various bodies of water. So they were very social. They presumably had conventions and taboos and ways of doing things, and they were very successful. We don't really know what happened to them, just as we don't know what happened to Neanderthals. Now, part of the reason I want to have this slide here is to remind ourselves that for a long period of time, so Homo sapiens has been around, us guys have been around for about 200,000 years. Long time. Now, organized religion as we know it has not been around for very much longer than about 3,000 to 4,000 years. So whatever were the moral practices and conventions and ways of getting on that humans used and that Homo erectus used, They worked very well for hundreds of thousands of years. And that's worth keeping in mind, because it's sometimes suggested that if we don't have religion, all hell will break loose. Maybe not. This is something I'm sure you're all familiar with, and that is sociality in organisms has almost certainly evolved many times. But that doesn't mean that the sociality is the same in all those organisms that are social. So you have discus fish, the male and the female like to be together. They exude a kind of mucus on their skin after the babies are born. And it's kind of like suckling. The babies attach themselves to the skin and eat the mucus and thereby acquire protein and grow. And of course, you know that termites are very social, ants are very social, and it's an absolutely essential part of their success that they are. But the sociality of mammals is completely different. It's very, very different, partly because we are so flexible. And the flexibility in social behavior that we see essentially in all mammals, including rats and mice, and also in primates, means that there's some aspect of our nervous system that is not sort of tied to or determined by the basic genetic organization of the brain. And so part of our story about sociality of humans is what that is all about. Now, before I give you the prevailing hypothesis on that, I first want to do one other little background thing. And this is really for philosophers who sometimes think that what they need to do is analyze concepts. And I'm sure Bartosz and his group have a very different way of going about things. But in any case, it's important to take this into account. So in the 60s, Eleanor Roche made a very interesting discovery that should have changed how philosophy was done, but by and large did not. The thing that she discovered was that our everyday categories, chair, house, vegetable, friend, and so forth, have a radial structure. What does that mean? It means that there are prototypes at the center, examples where we all agree, yes, this is a vegetable. And then there are fuzzy boundaries, examples where, well, you know, is parsley a vegetable or isn't it? Well, it actually doesn't matter for most things. I mean, some people can get very excited about whether parsley is a vegetable. I'm not one of them. And in between are a mixture of cases. So there's kind of a similarity metric, and the similarity to the prototype sort of falls off as you go to the boundaries. And this seems to be true of most of our everyday concepts, including concepts like nose and leaves. And the example, of course, is vegetable. And virtually everybody in the West, at any rate, if asked to name the first vegetable that comes to mind, we'll say carrot. Or another way, if you ask people, is carrot a vegetable, virtually everybody says yes. And what about radishes? Well, they're kind of partway out here. They're not really prototypical vegetables. A lot of people don't think of them as vegetables, but as garnishes. And then much further out are wild mushrooms. You might find them in the vegetable section of the supermarket, but that's not definitive, right? So some people think of them as vegetables, some people don't. As with parsley, it's not something I ever lost any sleep over. So we get along with the fact that for really important issues, we by and large can agree on the prototypes, and that's what matters. And the same is true of house. Now here I want to emphasize that, yes, there are prototypes, but notice that the prototypes are going to vary as a function of culture and ecology and so forth. So for the Inuit, that is a prototypical house. And if you live in Texas, it's probably more like that. I grew up in something not too different from that. And I knew friends who grew up in things that looked much like that. Now, the point I really want to make here is it's not that we must have necessary and sufficient conditions for what counts as a house. What we recognize is that there are prototypes, there are fuzzy boundaries, and moreover, that what counts as a prototype varies across cultures. And part of what varies is the ecology that makes certain kinds of houses prototypical. Now, why am I talking about this? And the answer is because I think social categories fall into this class of categories that have a radial structure. Some scientific categories we think of as not having a radial structure. So we can be very precise, for example, about what counts as oxidation, or we can be very precise about what a protein is, a string of amino acids. But that's science. And science, of course, rests on common sense and gets precise when it can. But the common sense vocabulary that we use, and this is certainly true of the social categories, is as Eleanor Roche described. So prototypes like friend, honest, kind, brave, trustworthy, all relevant to the moral domain, are learned by children by examples, not usually by being given a strict definition. Yes, he is a friend. No, he's probably not friendly. That was a mean thing to do. That was a kind thing to do, and so forth. And I think the same thing is true of the category moral versus not moral. We learn what should belong in those categories. They are contrasting, and we learn prototypes of what it is to be not moral and what it is to be moral. Yes, there are fuzzy boundaries, and at those fuzzy boundaries, sometimes we cannot agree. And sometimes, unlike the case of parsley, it matters. That is in the context of a criminal court. And when it does matter, we try very hard to come to a precise definition for the purposes of the court in order to move on. And this is a way, I think, of putting in a very different perspective much of the moral philosophy of the last century, which really consisted in trying to find a precise definition for what it is to be moral. That's not how we learn it, and that's not how we communicate about it in the most efficient way. So now back to the main theme, sociability. It turns out that for social mammals, and this is almost certainly true of social fish and insects, and definitely of birds, sociality is a basic value, just like it's a basic value, survival is a basic value also. And sociability is related to the value of survival, but not in an easy way. Sociability in mammals and in birds, but probably not in insects and fish, is supported by a very, very special molecule called oxytocin and its sibling molecule, vasopressin. And I'll talk a lot about oxytocin and vasopressin. They are by no means the only important parts of the story. There's also, just as Darwin recognized that habits are important, you don't acquire habits, that is, your brain doesn't acquire habits, unless the right chemicals are in play. And it's basically your subcortical structures that are part of the reward system and that tune up the cortex. So you must have a well-functioning reward system, and of course you must have a well-functioning cortex. Now, in this slide, I just want to, again, sort of distinguish between mammals and everything else. If anybody wants to talk about cortex in birds in the question period, I'd be happy to do that. But I'm going to leave them aside because it's a complicated story. Mammals, and only mammals, and maybe birds, have cortex. We don't see anything like it in a crocodile. So you can see that sort of pinky thing there in the crocodile. And you might think that's cortex because that's colored pink and so is that. But in actual fact, it's not. But what do I mean exactly by cortex? And so that's what I want to tell you now. But I should also just say that one of the sort of deep puzzles that we have in the evolution of the nervous system is we don't quite know how cortex evolved. We don't know how we got it. And you'll see when I show you exactly what a piece of cortex looks like, why that's a problem. Now, in this slide, what you're looking at is what's called a coronal section. It's as though I cut your brain this way, half of it this way, and half of it that way, so that you're looking at it crosswise. And it's the only part that is cortex is this part that is stained purple. What makes it different? Well, by and large, it's made up of the bodies of neurons, the central structure of the neuron. And that's what cortex is. And so you're looking at motor cortex in this slide and somatosensory cortex in this slide. But what makes cortex cortex? I said you've got all these cell bodies in there. So if you take a little bit of motor cortex, say, and blow it up, that's what it looks like. And there is nothing else in the nervous system that looks like that. Inasmuch as it has, to a first approximation, 6 layers. You can subdivide some of those layers into subcomponents. Very specific cell types are found in each layer. You never find, except in the case of autism, you never find these cells up here, these big fat guys. You never find these guys way down here, and so forth. So there are many types of neurons, and in cortex, they go to very specific places if development is normal. And that also means that there's very specific patterns of connections. So output always comes from here to other places in cortex. Input always goes into layer 4, and then there are very specific arrangements for what the cells in between do. So that's what cortex has. Well, what does an alligator have then in that pink part? And it's called sort of dorsal cortex. And what is dorsal cortex? Well, it doesn't have this tight, systematic, clean laminar structure. It's sort of, you know, a few neurons here, and maybe you could say there's a layer there. But cortex is completely new with mammals. Well, what's so great about cortex? Oh, yeah, this is a good slide, actually, just to show you that, of course, mammals have cortex, and that makes them special, and it gives them a domain of flexibility that other animals don't have. But it's not as though we don't still have the deep subcortical structures. And it's there that the reward system lives and does its work. And it's there that the motivational systems, the emotional systems live and do their work. And so part of what had to be figured out by, so to speak, Mother Nature was how to use this fancy cortex in connection with subcortical structures in an evolutionary context where, of course, the incompetent do not survive. So let's talk a little bit about, now this will be more speculative, about the evolution of mammals and why mammals might have this amazing nervous structure called cortex. So, of course, for millions of years, there were reptiles, and reptiles were extremely successful. And at some point, there were proto-mammals. And that basically means at some point, there were reptiles that had the capacity to maintain a constant temperature, who were warm-blooded. Well, what's so great about that? A lot of things. One huge advantage is that then you can forage at night when it's safer because those other really big hungry guys aren't around. They're And all of you who've ever had lizards or snakes as pets will know this, that the amount of food that a mammal must eat is gram for gram 10 times what a reptile must eat, because it has to sustain all of that mechanism for keeping you warm, and that takes a lot of calories. So yes, it's great, but all of a sudden your conditions, your ecological conditions change. And one of the ways in which they change is this. Whereas a patch, a small patch can support many, many lizards, a small patch can only support one or two foxes. And what it means then is that there has to be dispersal. In addition to that, it's a very good idea if you're warm-blooded and you have to be able to do all of this foraging at night and so forth. It's also very helpful if you're able to have a nervous system that has some flexibility so that you can go to a very new place and your brain will tune itself up to that environment in the sense that it will begin to understand the causality of the physical environment in which it's in. And those things are thought to be really important for the development of this new structure, cortex. And it also seems to have come together with another feature, and that is having very immature infants. Well, what's so good about having an immature infant? I mean, after all, it's nice if a frog just lays her eggs, off she goes, the tadpoles hatch, and they manage very well. Except that they do not have much in the way of flexibility. They do very well in a given environment, but unlike us, who can go to many, many different environments and thrive, they can't. So when very immature infants began to be born, they could tune themselves up, that is, their brains could be tuned up to the local environment because they had cortex. Here's the cost of having a very immature infant. Somebody's got to take care of it while its brain is being tuned up to its environment. And that's where the story of caring comes in. So there is a trade-off then between your learning capacity and the newborn independence. And I'm sure, as you all know, that humans have the longest period of immaturity of all mammals. And we think that this actually, of course, has a lot to do with the ability to form and use culture. So all of these things had to come together in an interesting way. But here is the problem for Mother Nature. How is she going to rig it so that an organism, which in the past we're used to, the mother would lay the eggs and take off, how are you going to change the brain so that the mother cares for the infant until the infant is mature enough to be independent? Oh, well, we'll come back. Oh, no, I guess maybe I should show you this. In this slide, I really just wanted to illustrate. This is a bit of cortex of a human. And it shows you what the cortex looks like at 1 month. And you can see that there are neurons, but they are kind of thin and spindly, and they don't have big bushy dendritic trees or big bushy axonal arborizations. And by age 4 years, much has changed. Okay. Now, what seems to have happened then is that there were fundamental changes in subcortical structures, mainly in the hypothalamus, and I'll show you what they are, that kind of reorganized the brain. And here was where oxytocin is really important. And they organized the brain to make a monumental change in the way organisms do business. And that was for the mother to treat the infant as an extension of herself. So whereas she cares for her own warmth and food and safety, she cares for the warmth and food and safety of the offspring every bit as much. Vocalization of the offspring came in at about the same time, so that when the offspring squeal because they're separated from the mother, That causes the mother pain. Everybody knows what it's like when the baby cries. And the mother takes corrective action. So in a way, this is kind of a remarkable development in the evolution of nervous systems, that we have both a very, very flexible brain that can tune itself up to many environments, but it's also a brain that is self-caring, but deeply other-caring. And that turns out to be a critical combination. So all vertebrates, mammals, reptiles, all have oxytocin or some very close variant thereof, and vasopressin, which is very, very similar to oxytocin, but plays a slightly different role in the mammalian brain. But in mammals, they were put to very new jobs. In frogs, for example, they're important for egg laying. And actually, in humans, oxytocin is important for parturition, for birth. It's involved in the contractions of the uterus. But other things were part of the job of oxytocin as well. And we know that when mothers and babies are in close proximity and they're in a happy circumstance, that oxytocin is released in the brain of the mother and also in the brain of the infant. And we know from rat studies that if infants are separated from the mother for even as little as 2 or 3 hours a day, that has an effect on the receptors in their brain for oxytocin. Behaviorally, it means that those deprived rats grow up with social deficits. We don't know exactly a comparable story for humans because obviously one doesn't do those sorts of experiments. Now, I don't want to emphasize oxytocin to the exclusion of other things. And in this slide that I got from Don Pfaff, who's an endocrinologist at Rockefeller, I just want to indicate that, of course, there are many other things going on. And one of the things that's going on that isn't actually in this slide is that in those loving situations of parents and offspring, almost certainly what has an important role are the endogenous opioids, those opioids that your own brain makes and allow you to feel good and contented and satisfied and so forth. And probably also the endogenous cannabinoids, which play a similar role, although they've been discovered only fairly recently, like in the last 10 years, and their exact role is not really well understood. So basically, here's how I'm thinking about this then, is that evolution sets the brain's style of drives and emotions. And some of those drives and emotions are drives for sociality. And then experience shapes the style, the particular conventions and social practices that a child learns. And of course, as I'm sure you all know, that this genes don't stop their work at birth. So what we know is that there is a very close interaction between gene expression and events that happen in the environment. All right, so that gives you just kind of the basic background of, roughly speaking, how we're thinking about the evolution of sociality in mammals and how it's tied to resources, to flexibility in the environment, and how immaturity turns out to be a really cool thing as long as you have a parent who's going to take care of you. But you might ask, so how is it that you get from mother-baby caring to other caring? What's the story there? Because probably the kind of sociality that we talk about when we think of it as a platform for moral behavior involves other than one's offspring. And here I'm going to talk about the prairie voles. Many of you will probably know the story of the prairie voles, so I'll go through it fairly quickly. There are many species of voles. They're kind of like little roly-poly mice. And I'm going to give you a behavioral contrast between two species, montane voles that live in the mountains and prairie voles that live out in the prairie. So the montane voles are more or less have a social pattern that you would probably associate with rodents. So the male and the female come along and they meet and they mate and then they go on their merry way. She goes and has the babies and he looks for more action. And so what happens in the case of the prairie voles? Nothing like that, right? Very close species, just lives in the prairie. So they meet, they mate, they are now bonded for life. They stay together for the rest of their lives. The male helps to raise the pups. The male guards the nest. He takes care of the female. The female is very bonded to him. And if they are separated, you can see the signs of depression to the degree that we can measure that in rodents. And so there's something very special that happens here. So when Sue Carter and Larry Young and a few other people noticed this, they asked the obvious question. What's the difference in the brain between the prairie voles and the montane voles? And they found a really interesting difference. Now, as you must know, in order for a chemical in the brain, a neurochemical, to have its effect, there has to be a receptor on a neuron to which it can attach itself, so it can change the responsivity of that neuron, so it can affect how that neuron responds. So the story I'm about to tell you is about receptors, and in particular about density of receptors. So in this slide, which is not really a beautiful slide, but it will do, we're looking again at a coronal section, and we are staining for oxytocin receptors and vasopressin receptors. Okay, so that's what the R is for in there, and this is the montane vole, and this is the prairie vole. So when we stain for oxytocin receptors, what we see is that in a structure called the nucleus accumbens, hugely important part of the reward system, there is a much, much higher density of receptors for oxytocin in the prairie vole than in the montane vole. And for vasopressin, a hugely larger density of receptors in another part of the reward system, the ventral pallidum. Okay, so you got a correlation. Is it a meaningful correlation, is the question. So they did all the usual things that you would suspect. They blocked the receptors of the little prairie voles, and then they didn't mate for life anymore. And then they took a mouse, and they genetically altered the mouse, so that the mouse would have a high density of receptors, and lo and behold, the mouse was quite happy to bond for life. And I should, by the way, as an aside, just say that bonding for life does not imply sexual exclusivity. And this is true of birds, too. There are many, many species of birds that bond for life, and we think it's a similar mechanism. But they all, both males and females, tend to get a little bit on the side. And I should also just say about prairie voles, so you don't think that all prairie voles are exactly the same. Of course, there's always a bell curve, right? So there are some prairie vole females who never really bond terribly well, and ditto for males. The other thing I should mention is that, of course, oxytocin and vasopressin are important for this bonding phenomenon. But that's not the only thing that's important. One thing is that they have to be able to recognize each other. So, right, you know, the male and the female, and they get together, and they meet, they mate. Oh, that's really wonderful. Well, we're bonded for life, and then she goes off and finds food, and he goes off. And then he can't remember which vole she was. And we can bring that about by changing dopamine levels in the reward system. So if we change dopamine so that they can't remember, they can't bond. I mean, it's kind of sad, really, because it's like he's looking for her, but he can't remember who she is. All right. So it's a very, very interesting thing. Now, my own feeling is that the really big genetic change comes with early mammals and this extension of me to include me and mine. And that this actually involves a relatively small genetic change. A genetic change that it doesn't really consist in kind of rewiring the hypothalamus and so forth. But it's nevertheless a very important change. And we think that comparable changes probably underlie the bonding that we see between mates in other species, like marmosets. Have I got a marmoset? I'll show you a marmoset in a minute. That small genetic changes affect the bonding between mates in other species, and also other changes will affect wanting to be with kin, so that in baboons, for example, there are the matrilineal lines, line one, line two, line three, and they all kind of hang out together and take care of each other. That is this mom and this daughter and her daughter and her daughter. So I think those things can probably be brought about with comparably small genetic changes. So the part of the story where I am now then has moved beyond parent-offspring attachment to parent-offspring mates and maybe friends and kin. Okay. So in highly social mammals then, I think we see this extension of me and mine to go to me and mine and others. Probably the bonds between me and kin are stronger than between me and kith. By kith, of course, that's just an old Scottish word for friends. And up here, you'll see a pair of marmosets. These are South American monkeys. They're very small. They're about this big. And they also bond for life. The dad takes care of the babies to actually a greater extent than the mom. And interestingly, in marmosets, we find other behaviors that I think kind of are useful in reflecting on the fact that we are not entirely unique with regard to our moral behavior. The male marmosets will often adopt orphan babies and sort of bring them into the family and help take care of them and so forth. And Chris Besch, who is an anthropologist in Germany, has seen this in chimpanzees as well. Even when there is no genetic connection between the dad, the adoptive father, and the offspring. So I want to say a little bit more about oxytocin. The fact is that much remains to be discovered about what exactly oxytocin does, but it does appear to act in a counterway against stress hormones, so that when stress hormones go up, oxytocin tends to go down. And so if there is an individual and another one comes into the area and makes a sort of ingratiating behavior or indicates that there's nothing bad's going to happen, stress hormones go down, oxytocin levels go up, and it's as though in that context there is a capacity or a willingness to sort of sit down, be together, and it's probably also a condition that permits cooperative behavior. So just so that you know, these are schematics, of course, of the brain. This is the hypothalamus, and it's shown again in green over here. And it's really from this old, old subcortical structure that oxytocin, vasopressin, and other things like prolactin come. And so oxytocin in the hypothalamus is released mainly from neurons in two separate structures. And it can be released into the peripheral system. So you will find, if you took measurements, that you have oxytocin in your ovaries, in your testes, in your heart, in your kidneys. But there's also a branch that releases oxytocin and it diffuses into other areas of the brain. And we think that's the place where it's important for this sort of social behavior that characterizes humans. Now, Darwin talked about the importance of habit, and I haven't said too much about that, except that the subcortical structures, the reward system structures in the nucleus accumbens and the ventral striatum are very, very important for habit learning. And that it's those structures that change as a child learns the ways and the conventions and the social practices of the group. With an enlarged prefrontal cortex, and humans' prefrontal cortex appears to be larger proportional to our body size than that of chimpanzees or baboons or monkeys. With that enlarged prefrontal cortex, we think that there is also a greater capacity for problem solving, for sort of seeing what the consequences of one proposal are relative to another as cashed out into the future. We think that, and this touches on the talk on self-control I gave on Tuesday, that it also means there is a greater capacity for self-control. Although we have seen that even in rats, there can be quite a striking capacity for self-control. In humans also, because we have so much, so to speak, storage space in our brains, and because we have a rather large hippocampal structure, we can remember who did what to whom, and this is, of course, before the internet, where we now rely on. And that allowed us a kind of record keeping of social good behavior and social bad behavior. Okay, so that's the general picture. And now I sort of want to give you an example of what I think of as an instance of cooperative behavior that probably emerges quite naturally given the sociality of the animals. And this is going to be a story about wolves. And in a wolf pack, the animals like to be together. And when there is an event that calls for joint action, they will howl. And not unlike your dog who jumps all over you and licks you and so forth, the wolves come to the central howler. And they all meet and they all jump on each other and lick each other, and then the alpha male mounts everybody so everybody knows who's in charge. And in this instance, they're going hunting, and so off they go. And this just reminds us that there are huge advantages to being social. And what these guys are doing in this slide is driving off a grizzly from his kill. So there's the grizzly who's gone to a great deal of trouble, no doubt, to bring down a caribou. And the wolves arrive. And the wolves will harass and harass and harass the grizz. Now, he is vastly huger than they. He's very fast, even though he's big. And it's a very dangerous thing that they're engaged in. But they will succeed. And they will drive him off. But it's only because they act together in a group. And notice how reinforcing that is, right? Then they get to tuck into this great big caribou and have a feast. However, before they get too far, look who's here. A raven. How did the wolves know where to go? And the answer is that from time to time, ravens and wolves act together. So the raven can fly all over the forest, 20 miles away, sees the grizz with the kill, flies back to where the wolves are, and signals to the wolves that there's goodies to be had. And off they go. They follow the raven. Well, what's in it for the raven? Now, it's not because the raven really likes the wolves, right? the wolves really like each other. What happens then is eventually he goes and gets his pals, and when the wolves are eating the grizzly, caribou, the ravens arrive and they will drive off the wolves. Now you might be surprised at that, but if you are, go to YouTube or something and take a good look at a raven beak. I had the unfortunate event where I was in my cabin and my dog was harassing the raven, and the raven took a huge chunk of fur off the dog's back and flew into the house, sat on the rocking chair, and stared at me. And it had a beak like that, and I thought, yes, ma'am, you just tell me what to do, and I'll do it. So they're very dangerous, and this was a sizable strip, and my dog was not little. The wolves will eventually be driven off. Now, that's a very different kind of cooperation between the wolves and the ravens than the cooperation between the ravens and between the wolves themselves. Now, I told you at the beginning that my real love and my real interest is in neurobiology, and in this case, in neuroendocrinology, and that the story of morality has two parts. There's the biological part, and there's the politics in this grand sense of politics. And there are many, many people who have written about culture, and that's not particularly where I want to go, except to say that I think Philip Kitcher's book and all of these books actually are really, really super in talking about the idea that our conventions have a lot to do with the prosperity and the stability of a group, with the contingencies that are imposed on us by the environment. So it's no surprise, for example, that the Inuit who live in the high Arctic have a rather different set of conventions from the Pidha who live a very idyllic sort of existence on the banks of the Amazon River in Brazil. And it's important, I think, to see that underlying all those differences, there can be these commonalities, but that we should not necessarily be looking for absolute laws that define rightness for all times, for all conditions, for all people. Certainly, as this takes us back to the early slide of Homo sapiens, and we know Homo sapiens came out of Africa, spread into Europe, and about 10,000 years ago, they began to collect into larger and larger groups. Agriculture was started, people began to herd and tend animals as well as to grow things. And you get the beginnings of villages and towns. And with that you get several things. One is not everybody knows everybody else really well. And you may not know some people at all in your village or in your town. And that introduces a social dynamic that's a little bit different. From living in a small group where a mere frown or a stare or a look is enough to tell you that you ought not to do what you're doing. And in this context, there was almost certainly a division of labor. Not only a division of labor that involved some people being farmers and some being traders, some making shoes and others making bread. It probably also involved a division of labor for those who were sort of in charge of religious beliefs. And initially the religious beliefs, to the degree that we can tell from hunter-gatherer societies, involved many spirits. Spirit of the sun, of the water, of rain, spirit of fertility, spirit of dirt, spirit of this and that and the other thing. And it was a very natural thing in the absence of really having a developed science to know about causality, it was a very natural thing to do. And with the development of these large towns where not everybody knows everybody else, it was probably useful to have formalization of some of your practices and conventions, by which I mean to have it clearly written down that certain things are unacceptable and other things are okay. And I think it's really only then that we get the emergence of what you might call systematic religion, or religion that kind of takes the place of a small village where everybody knows everybody and my frown is enough to make you quit doing whatever it is that you're doing. And so we have the idea springing up that there are gods who are invisible, who are watching you, even though you can't see them, and you're all by yourself. And I think that that probably was an important part of the development of social groups. And so, for example, in this slide, I hope I'm not offending anybody, but the idea that we're all taught as children, that there are divine beings who can see us do those things we're not supposed to do, even though our mom and dad and our friends can't see us. And that may have served a useful role, although it may not. We also know that there are societies where there are religions that don't have divine beings and that don't have invisible spirits and ghosts and so forth. What I haven't touched on is also, I think, a hugely important topic, and that has to do with aggression. Aggression between groups, especially this appears to have happened after the advent of agriculture and the growth of large cities. But it's something that I can't talk about today because it turns out to be a hugely complex topic. So I'm going to end with a slide that sort of brings together a couple of the themes of the talk. And one is that we like to be together. That's part of what sociality in mammals is really all about, and sociality in birds too. And sometimes, as long as conditions permit, we don't really care whether it's our own species or not. In fact, I know lots of humans who would much rather be with dogs than with other humans. And this slide is particularly interesting because in biology classes, many of us are taught that orangs, unlike, say, chimpanzees or baboons, orangs are solitary. And of course, it's quite true that although there is a mother-infant period, that baboons orangs tend to be on their own. But that's largely because they are foraging for vegetation, and you can only have one or two orangs in a very large area. Given the opportunity to be social, they are. And I think it's quite striking in this slide how these two get on. This was taken at a rescue center for primates, and old Rusty there was hanging out, more or less by himself, just kind of hanging out. And this old coonhound comes up and comes into the compound. And he kind of sniffs around and checks out various things, and he finds Rusty. And they sort of sat down together, and they've essentially been inseparable ever since. So with that, I want to conclude. And in English, that's the title of the book. But I just also want to say I'm so thrilled to have that book translated and published in Poland. So thank you so much for that. Oh, I see. So you want me to do this. Does this work? Yep. Okay.
So, we have time for questions, please.
Oh.
If no one else volunteers, let me try.
Yeah, you go.
Okay, so that's a very general, kind of vague methodological question concerning the project, because you began with this idea that the moral concept as what is right, what is wrong, what is acceptable or not, has this character of being gradual or vague in one way or another. And I just wonder, how should we proceed with our project of correlating this conceptual structure, our moral conceptual scheme, let's say, with the conceptual scheme that we developed to describe brain, or structure of the brain, or the function of the functioning of the brain. And I just wonder whether this radial character, or a moral concept, should be somehow paralleled with the radial or vague character of our scientific neurological concepts.
Oh yeah, that's just a wonderful question. So what, let me see if I understand your question, if I put it this way. So suppose you ask, so what do we know about categorization in nervous systems? Like, how does the nervous system actually make these categories? Now, the really honest answer is that we don't really know at this point. However, we do actually have a model that kind of gets us into a space of hypotheses. And the model derives from artificial neural nets. And what we know is that artificial neural nets, whether their learning is done by what's called unsupervised learning or whether it's by feedback, that artificial neural nets will learn to categorize and will learn to, for example, to distinguish male faces from female faces. They will learn also to give an answer to a face that's ambiguous, if I, you know, deliberately do that. So I give the neural net that's been trained up on faces, I give it a brand new face that's ambiguous, it will sort of say, it's not clear. And so it turns out that artificial neural nets have provided a kind of insight for how real neural nets are probably doing categorization. But the actual truth is that we don't know in detail how real nervous systems do it. What you'd like to do is to be able to do it in a simple organism first, but we don't know very much about how, say, Drosophila categorize. We know much more in the case of monkeys, and we can find specific neurons that respond to specific stimuli, but that what we need to have are recordings from many, many neurons simultaneously so that we can verify or falsify the hypothesis that neural nets provide, to a first approximation, a model of how categorical learning is done. Good question.
You've spoken a lot today, fascinating, about behaviors that we do understand in terms of neuroscience, in terms of advances we make. What behaviors, I guess perhaps in humans, but I guess it could be in primates, are today still completely confounding, where we don't understand the basis of them? What are the challenges going forward?
That's also a really wonderful question. There are, I think, for almost all behaviors in mammals, we only understand a fraction. So we understand a little bit about short-term memory. We understand a little bit about how information gets transferred from hippocampus to permanent consolidated homes in cortex. But we really do not understand at all how you retrieve that memory. So if I ask you, do you ever remember seeing your father or your grandfather smoke a pipe? Some of you will instantly, it'll be right there. You'd think it would take a while, but it doesn't. It's very fast, and we don't quite understand how that's done. So in neuroscience, I think there's this kind of hand-holding between the computational modeling, like the kind I was talking about, and these other big problems. There are some aspects of the problem of conscious experience that I think we are really beginning to understand. We've made quite a lot of progress in understanding how anesthetics work and in understanding what happens in deep sleep. But I wouldn't say that the problem is solved. On the other hand, there are philosophers who notoriously say, it's unsolvable forever. And, I don't know how they can, I mean, that's quite a prediction, actually. Ever is quite a long time. So there are many aspects of the problem of consciousness that are not solved, but we've made progress on that problem, which I think 10 years ago people would have thought was quite impossible. We really also, I mean, this is a problem I think about a lot. We know that for almost every interesting function in a mammalian brain, it involves distributed networks across cortex, but also networks in subcortical structures, in the amygdala that's involved with emotions and in the reward structures. But there is no guy in there who's telling, you know, who's conducting the whole thing. So the really deep question here that really bothers a lot of us in neuroscience is, how is the coordination problem solved? How is it that when I decide to touch my nose, that lo and behold, I touch my nose, not my foot? I mean, how does that all come together so smoothly? And we really don't know. Now, the other thing I'll just mention, since I have the mic, is that in, you know, modern medicine is a great marvel, and many of us are absolutely astonished at the things that we can now take advantage of that our parents or our grandparents could not. There are over 600 diseases of the nervous system, and some of them, of course, or most of them, essentially all of them, I guess, are truly pretty terrible. We have understanding of almost none. And for almost none do we have adequate interventions. We don't know about what causes any of the dementias. There are hypotheses. Some of them are sort of okay, and some of them are sort of not. We don't have the first idea, really, what causes schizophrenia, which affects 1% of the population. Nobody has the slightest idea what causes multiple sclerosis, and I could go on. So part of what I think keeps many of us going in neuroscience is the prospect that basic discoveries about the brain may well yield an understanding of things like autism and schizophrenia and bipolar disorder and depression and so forth. I mean, I'm sure many of you will know that Parkinson's, of course, is a very terrible disease, especially when it afflicts the young. And one of the treatments now, which is fairly effective for a subset of people, consists in implanting an electrode well down deep in below the cortex into a structure called the subthalamic nucleus and turning on the electricity. And it actually does work for quite a few people. And there's a wonderful bit of film on YouTube. Nobody knows how it works. I'm not joking. We have the slightest idea how it works. Now, that doesn't mean that it's not a good thing. And if I had Parkinson's and was debilitated by it, you bet I'd try it. But that's just by way of saying that there are many fundamental mysteries here, and that on the clinical front, some of these mysteries are really crying out for solution, because these diseases can be so devastating, so catastrophic, and so life-destroying. Thanks.
Oh, Bippin has a question. I may have to run from the room after Bippin's question.
It's the simple one. In your last slide, you showed an orang who are typically solitary, and they are socializing. That orang is socializing with a dog. Now, one could also take another example, like maybe wolves who are very social, and one could perhaps find an example when a wolf is solitary, for example.
Yes.
Right? So what I'm asking is that, do you actually feel that, evolutionary speaking, we are going towards larger and larger social structures, because it could be the other reason where social structure is maybe harmful and it's breaking, and maybe in the future maybe more isolated structures, that kind of system will win out as opposed to the larger and larger social structure. So what is your feeling about
Well,
did I make it clear? Or?
Not exactly. I mean, I think your question is, are we tending to become more and more social?
Are we going towards like larger and larger social structure so that even, you know, I mean, like from me to kin and kids, that structure becomes bigger and bigger and bigger evolutionary?
Oh, I see. Okay. Right. Yeah, I see. Okay. That is a nice question. I actually am sort of realist about this. I tend to think that as long as conditions permit, that one can extend generosity beyond the family to strangers and people on the other side of the planet and so forth. But I think by and large, when times are really tough, that people are most likely to pull in and take care of kin first. I think so. And that's why, you know, there. People were asking me yesterday about Steve Pinker's book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, which I like very much, and it has a very optimistic ending. And I've talked to Steve about this, and I said, well, look, you know, what do you think will happen when the food runs out? Will people be as generous then? I bet not. Not because I think people are bad or mean or evil or anything like that. I just think that's the nature of the thing, of the reality of ourselves. So I think much depends, as it did in the case of the orang. The conditions were fine. He was well fed every day. He didn't have to go foraging for his leaves. They were provided in his dish every day. He could afford to have pals. In the woods, he camped. So I think much actually depends on how harsh circumstances actually are. And we know that humans are capable, when they feel that they are up against it, of doing things that would otherwise seem to them inconceivable. Absolutely. Yeah. That's a very sobering thought. I hope somebody has a funny question. Yes.
Well, the particular is funny, but still. My question is that at some point you suggested that there is some sort of link between the fact that there appear some sort of universal norms and systems of belief that support them. There is a link with the greater complexity of societies. Yes, like going through this farming phase, etc., etc. But from the cultural anthropology, we know well enough that even very, what we wouldn't call primitive societies, like Aboriginal societies, still have very rich systems of belief and mythologies.
Oh, absolutely.
So how would that fit into this narrative?
You mean complex beliefs of a social nature about appropriate practices and so forth? Oh, yeah. No, I think that those sorts of social practices emerge very naturally for a group given their conditions. So, for example, if you think about the Inuit, at least until they were, you know, westernized or Europeanized or whatever, but to some extent this is still true now, they really, really frown on aggression within the group. And if there is to be aggression, I mean, none of us likes to have our siblings go at one another. But of course, that's part of the package, right? Because it's not that you don't have self-care just because you have other care, and sometimes there's tension. But in the Inuit groups, that is really, really frowned upon. And anything that really jeopardizes the stability and the welfare of the group is frowned upon and considered very, very unacceptable. And it's not surprising to see why, right? Because they live on the knife edge of survival. And here's another sort of example from the Inuit. I guess as a Canadian, I happen to know a little bit more about them than the Pedaho. But anyway, they actually regard deception as worse than murder. And that seems surprising to us. How could that possibly be? Well, that's just because you're sure about your own moral intuitions. But bear in mind that other people think about it differently. Why do they think deception is so terrible? And the answer is this, that typically if there is murder within the group, it's usually over a woman, and it's one man killing another man. And they have a convention whereby if that happens, that's the end of it. There is to be no feuding, no retribution, no nothing. That's the end of it. Deception, so it doesn't destabilize the whole group, it doesn't put the whole group in jeopardy. And if you're living at 50 below zero and you never know whether there's going to be food or not, it's a good idea to have a lot of stability. Deception can threaten the whole group. And I'll give you an example. It comes from the great anthropologist Rasmussen, who spent a lot of time in the Arctic. So it turned out that there was a lad of about 14 who was really a rascal in the camp. And at one point, his father was off on a hunt, and he was still in the camp. And one of the things he did was he very stealthily ran around and collected plover's eggs and let them rot. And then he hid them all behind a big rock. And they were living at this point close to the ocean, so that ships very rarely, like once every 2 or 3 years, would come into the harbor. So a ship came in, so he decided to announce that a ship came in. So he stood there and he said, "A ship is coming, a ship is coming," and everybody got very excited and all the villagers ran down, and then he threw these rotten eggs at them. Now, it's not like they have washing machines and they're, you know, I mean, it was a terrible thing to do. So his mother had kind of had the end of it when this happened. So she said to the man who was sort of in charge now that the father was gone, "Take him out and throw him down a crevasse." And he did. Now, actually, it was a funny story because the kid survived. Nobody expected him to, because usually if you're thrown down a crevasse, you know, you die pretty quickly. But he managed to ooch his way down to the bottom, and then he managed to get out as the water was flowing towards the ocean, and he circled around and came back to camp. And then he'd sort of learned his lesson, I guess, that if he was going to be deceptive and imperil the whole group, that they would definitely do him in. But the stories from Rasmussen and Franz Boas and others about the Inuit are quite revealing because, given such harsh circumstances, they do have slightly different conventions. And not keeping disabled infants was, of course, very common. You put them out on the ice floe. You cannot possibly hope to feed everybody if not everybody can be productive. And as you know, the elder, once they ceased to be productive, were expected to leave their clothes behind, go out onto the ice floe, and that would be that. It's a fairly quick and painless death, I'm told, but at any rate, this is just by way of reminding us that we live in very posh circumstances. And so, you know, it's very easy for me to be horrified at the idea of leaving a disabled baby on an ice floe because I can't take care of it. But for them, it's a matter of life and death of the group, of everybody in the group. And so these stories, it doesn't mean that you have to agree with everything that they do, but it does mean that it broadens your perspective about why particular conventions are in place and the ways in which the ecology kind of forces the hand of the problem solvers.
I think we have time for one short question, one last short question.
Thank you for the lecture. What I'd like to ask is, what are the differences in mammals, basically, in oxytocin levels, or how bodies manage it, between males and females. Mm-hmm. And is it responsible, for example, for different family lifestyles? Like, what I mean is that there are groups, like in elephants, led only by females, and males are solitary, and there are, for example, beavers that live in mixed families. Is it about it, oxytocin, vasopressin, and so on, or is it about something different?
That's a really, really wonderful question, and we really don't know, is the answer. Now, I mean, I would love to know, because as you rightly point out, there are these sort of differences in style. I mean, even amongst, say, the differences between the bonobos and the chimpanzees. And you really would like to know what the circuitry differences are that make for these quite different patterns of social behavior. And probably oxytocin and vasopressin are part of the story. So I should just say that we think that, but don't know, except for rodents, that oxytocin is more prevalent in females than in males. But we do find oxytocin in both. And interestingly, upon the birth of humans, there is an increase in oxytocin levels in females, no surprise there, but also in the dads. And we now are seeing that also in rats. Rats, you'd think. But the thing about vasopressin is it seems to be important for, how shall I say, for defensive behavior, for being able to sort of get yourself together in order to drive off an intruder and that kind of thing. And there, when it's a matter of defending the nest against intruders, females, of course, can be every bit as difficult or as vicious in the defense of the young as males, in some cases more so. And again, YouTube is a great thing. So there's this wonderful YouTube video. So the dog is at the bottom of the tree and has the baby squirrel in his mouth. And the mother comes down the tree, throws herself at the dog's face. I mean, it's unbelievable. She throws herself at the dog's face. The dog, of course, whoa, what's happening? And the baby and the mom, go back up the tree. And we know, of course, mother bears. I mean, you would never, ever, ever cross a mother with an infant. Not even if you smiled and nodded politely, you would just, you know, get out. There's so much about the endocrine story we don't know here. And part of it, I mean, I mentioned aggression, but aggression is so much more ancient than is social caring. And how exactly that all works with oxytocin and vasopressin, whether the degree to which aggression really involves pleasure and a release of the endorphins, it's all open. And there are labs looking at that. Yeah, great question.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And I think